So far, we've been talking about lots of different types of neurons in primary visual cortex. Simple cells, orientation selective cells, direction selective cells, disparity selective cells. But let's not lose sight of the fact that all these neurons are here to encode information about the visual input and enable our brains to work out what's out there in the world. As we were stressing earlier, we did not evolve to deduce information about photons on our retina, we're trying to work out what's out there in the real world. So how do these neurons in primary visual cortex enable the rest of the brain to do this? It's natural to think that cells that are tuned to the orientation of a line encode information about the orientation of that line. They're telling the rest of the brain there's an edge at this particular orientation, at this location in the visual field. But actually, you can't deduce orientation from the activity in any one neuron. Let's take a neuron like this. It's got an orientation tuning curve that I've tried to sketch out here, so firing rate in spikes per second, and it is tuned to zero orientation, which represents a vertical bar. Fine. So immediately we have an ambiguity. If it's firing at 90, we could say, fine, the cell must be seeing a bar at zero, its preferred orientation. But what if the firing rate is 40 spikes per second? There are two orientations that give that output, and so you won't know whether the orientation in the receptive field is plus or minus 15 degrees. And that's not the only ambiguity, there are other much more serious ones. But primary visual cortex doesn't just contain one neuron at each location. As we've seen, it contains a range of neurons tuned to different orientations at the same location. So this represents a little chunk of primary visual cortex, what Hubel and Wiesel called a hypercolumn. So it represents neurons that are all tuned to roughly the same location in the retina, but you've got some of them in layer 4, you've got neurons that are receiving input from the left eye and the right eye. In the other layers, they're mainly binocular. And you've got these columns of preferred orientation. So all the neurons in this little part are tuned to the same location on the retina, but to different orientations. And I've just taken 5 of those neurons and sketched out their orientation tuning curve. So they're all tuned to different orientations, okay? And these little triangles and the colours represent the neuron and its corresponding tuning curve. Okay, so now what the brain has is not the output of any one neuron, but of all 5 of these neurons together. So let's imagine that you're the brain trying to work out what's on your retina, and what's actually there is a little piece of image that's at minus 15 degrees. So I've marked that with this blue vertical line here. And the horizontal red line shows with the point on the orientation tuning curve of the red neuron, so we can see how much the red neuron is going to respond to this stimulus. And I'm going to mark this on what's conceptually a different graph, but I'm going to superimpose it. I hope that's not too confusing. I'm going to show the height of this bar represents how much the red neuron is responding to this little minus 15 degrees. Now, as we've seen, if we only had the red neuron, we'd have this ambiguity. We wouldn't know whether the stimulus was minus 15 degrees or plus 15 degrees. But actually, we have this whole population, so let's think how the other neurons are responding. So I'm going to mark on where the green neuron is responding. So that's the height of the green tuning curve at this minus 15 degrees. And that gives me the firing rate of the green neuron. And I can do that for the blue neuron, we'll just get a very little response there, and the yellow and the other green neuron, the light green neuron, are not responding at all because their orientation tuning curves have already fallen to zero at this point. So if you're the brain and you see a pattern like this, with the blue neuron responding very little, the green a bit more and the red quite a lot, then you can deduce that the retinal stimulus must be minus 15 degrees, and there isn't that ambiguity. The population has enabled you to read out the orientation in a way that a single neuron just couldn't on its own. Now let's think about the other orientation, plus 15 degrees. Remember, the red cell's responding the same as it was for minus 15 degrees, so there's no change there. But now the difference is that the yellow neuron is now responding much more strongly than it was before. In fact, just a tiny bit stronger than the red neuron. And so by looking at that activity, the brain can tell that this must be plus 15 degrees instead of minus 15 degrees by looking at the activity of the whole population. What if the stimulus doesn't just have one orientation? What if there are two lines present at this particular point on the retina with different orientations? Well, again, this population can encode that, and this time we would have two peaks of activity. So for the example shown here, we have one bar that's tuned to around minus 60, so this blue neuron here is responding a lot, and then we have another bar that's tuned to about plus 30, so the yellow neuron is responding a lot. And so in that way, when you see a double peaked population activity like this, you can work out that there must be two different orientations present. Another problem faced by the brain is that as well as encoding orientation, cells are simultaneously encoding contrast. Most cells will fire more for higher contrast stimuli. So if this is the cell's orientation tuning curve for high contrast, so I've got the different gratings now, different orientations, and that's the cell's firing rate on average for a grating of this orientation when the grating is high contrast. What happens as we reduce the contrast of the grating? Well, we get the same shaped tuning curve with a peak at the same location, but all the firing rates are just that little bit lower. And so again, this leads to ambiguity. You can't in fact deduce either orientation or contrast from the firing of any individual neuron. So you, as the brain, trying to interpret the activity of this neuron, if you only had access to this one neuron, you wouldn't know whether this level of firing rate represented the cell's response to a stimulus that had low contrast but the optimum orientation, or a stimulus that had a suboptimal orientation but somewhat higher contrast. So again, there's this inherent ambiguity in the response of individual neurons. So let's see how we can read out orientation and contrast from a population. Imagine we've got a high contrast vertical stimulus like here. The response of this population will be something like this. The cell that's responding most strongly will be the red cell because vertical is its preferred orientation. And then the ones tuned to adjacent orientations will also be responding somewhat. Now suppose we have the same stimulus but it's low contrast. The overall response of all the neurons will reduce because neurons generally respond more to high contrast than to low contrast stimuli. But once again, the neuron that's responding strongest will be the one tuned to vertical orientations. So overall then, the brain can deduce the orientation of the particular location on the retina from which neurons at that position are responding most strongly, and it can deduce the contrast from how strong the overall response is. Now, this is definitely a massive simplification, but hopefully it gives you an idea of how this population can represent information about what's on the retina. When we're thinking about information being encoded by a population of neurons, we could also ask with what precision do the neurons encode this information? Suppose you wanted to be really sensitive to very fine changes in orientation. How would you go about that? Well, it seems that it would be sensible to have neurons with very narrow, sharply peaked orientation tuning curves. And the rationale there is that a very small change in orientation is causing a big change in average firing rate. So even though there's going to be some noise, some fluctuations about the mean, if these two average firing rates are sufficiently different, the brain will be able to tell them apart and you'll be able to discriminate between two orientations that are very similar. Now the problem is if I just take my original five neurons that I've been using so far and now make all their orientation tuning curves narrower and sharper so that each of them is giving more precise information about orientation, I now have this problem that they don't, as it were, tile the space. I get gaps. And so the nature of the problem here is that you'd end up, for a stimulus at 15 degrees, say, none of the neurons would actually be responding. So your brain wouldn't know the stimulus was even there. It would be like at a particular orientation, objects would vanish. So that clearly wouldn't be very good. And so if you're going to want to have these really sharp, precise tuning curves, now you need more neurons. Just like if you want to tile your bathroom with very small tiles, you're going to need more of them. So that's great. When you have lots of cells with sharp tuning like this, then you're encoding really precise, detailed information about the property in question. So here, orientation. The cost is, of course, now you've got twice as many neurons as we needed before to span that range of orientation. And remember, this is just one location on the retina. And neurons are expensive, and firing action potentials is expensive. It uses up energy. And actually, our brains already use 20% of the energy of our whole body. So you can see that an organism is going to be reluctant to do this in the sense that in evolution, it's going to be selected against having more and more neurons. Where are you going to put them all for a start? So over evolution, each species decides, as it were, whether it's worth building lots of cells to encode information very precisely, or whether they could get by with coarser, cheaper information. And that might actually be a better ecological strategy. It's a bit like the resolution of the eye. So in theory, it's great to have really good resolution, lots of photoreceptors, but maybe that doesn't benefit your particular ecological niche. Maybe you're a mouse that doesn't need to see very well, so there's no point in building lots of expensive photoreceptors. Whereas maybe if you're a falcon flying overhead trying to spot the mice, maybe it is worth having that really good resolution. And so lots and lots of photoreceptors and lots of brain cells to deal with that. We'll see a similar trade-off. We'll see how humans have traded off coarse versus fine encoding when we discuss colour later.